You hear that? That is Bigfoot mimicking you. He says, that's what you sounded like the night you two met up in the forest. So, I've now heard his story of what happened. I want to hear your side of the story next. Go on, put it all down in detail in an email and send it to contact@BuckeyeBigfoot.com. I can't wait to hear this. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hey there, everyone. I'm glad to see y'all. Now, tonight, it's a very mixed bag of things. We've got a run-in with the big guy. Another that's not exactly a run-in with the big guy. And then we got one in the middle that is just, well, I don't know, but I liked it, and I thought you might, too. All right, everyone. Well, let's get on in those saddles, and let's get moving. And don't forget, pack your extra snackage in those saddlebags, because, you know, there's never enough nibble snackage on the journey down into Sasquatch Valley. Are you ready? Hello. I would like to share my stories with you. My first encounter happened when I was about 10 years old. I'm now 58. Growing up in Louisiana, we learned to hunt and fish starting at an early age. My pawpaw, Uncle Bo, and I were squirrel hunting in the Dolet Hills near Mansfield, Louisiana, in early September. I got lost from them. Back then, the woods were massive. Miles and miles of nothing but woods. So, I had run until almost dark when the realization set in that I was spending the night out there. I had shot several squirrels, so I made a fire, prepared the squirrels, and settled in. I would find my way out in the morning once I knew which way was east. It had been dark for some time when I heard footsteps coming towards me. They stopped just outside of the firelight, so I couldn't see what had walked up on me. I could tell that it was two-legged and not four-legged, and it was heavy. I called out. No answer. I called out again. No answer. I got my shotgun. I had put slug and double-op buck in my shotgun. I pointed my shotgun in the direction I last heard the footsteps. When I did that, the most horrible growling I have ever heard started. This thing circled my camp three times, breaking trees and thrashing them, throwing some of them at me. Then I heard it walk off. I climbed a tree as high as I could get after that and never went to sleep. Daylight couldn't come fast enough. When it did, I climbed down when I could see clearly and started heading east to the road. As I moved out, I could see a tree as big as me pulled out of the ground. I made it to the road, and another hunter picked me up and drove me to our camp. I never said a thing. Over the years, I have heard others that have encountered something in Dolet Hills. Some never made it out alive. I will have to email you the other encounters another time. They occurred in Tulumne County, California, which has more sightings than anywhere else. Signed, Greg Turner. Nance, this is not a sighting, but my father loved the idea of Bigfoot. Growing up outside of Ottumwa, Iowa, on the bluegrass, he heard stories of the elusive creature. When my father was in his 20s, he started logging and spent a lot of time in the woods, farm fields, and pastures. Being a logger, he made a lot of noise and drove off any creatures lurking around the woods. At about the age of 38, he dropped a tree into a bunch of deadfalls in the Red River Valley in northern Minnesota. Knowing that it was dangerous, he watched until everything stopped moving. As soon as he turned, a limb came out of nowhere and hit him in the shoulder and ended his logging career. Busted up his shoulder, broke three ribs, and bruised his lung. After a year of laying on the couch recovering from his injuries, he moved on to other work, but I know the woods were calling him. My father was a guest on Darkness Radio several years ago. I wish I had a copy of the interview. He believed that Bigfoot spoke in a Native American language of sort. My dad posted on many groups. Here he is being quoted on Crypto Zoo News on CryptoZooNews.com. The finding that some hoaxing of tracks was occurring along with genuine tracks has since been supported by the recollections of Larry Hagedorn. He made them in 2001 in postings to the list Bigfoot at YahooGroups.com. He wrote, "When I was growing up in Wapello County, Iowa, we used to have that many sightings in the teens, reported almost every year. Yes, there were some frauds mixed in. Making Bigfoot tracks by the light of the moon was a common pastime. One of the reasons that fraud was a popular sport was the frequency of the sightings by sober, upstanding members of the community." He also posted the following story on Southern Iowa, BigfootEncounters.com. Southern Iowa. "I live in Minnesota now, but I was born and raised in Southern Iowa in well-known Bigfoot territory, Ottumwa, Bloomfield, and Lockridge. There have been many sightings in these areas. The local papers used to carry stories occasionally, and the archive should be a treasure trove of information for researchers. I have some knowledge of two sightings in particular. The following is a sighting as told to me by Dick Hopkins, an old friend. Dick's son, as I recall his name is David, saw this Bigfoot when he was around 10 or 12. This would have been approximately 25 years ago. The area south of Bloomfield, Iowa, is rough clay hills with lots of brush, mixed oak timber in the hills, and maple and cottonwood timber in the many creek bottoms. Multiflora roses were introduced to make living fences. They naturalized and spread out, and some areas are pretty darn near impenetrable. Farm fields tend to be 5 to 10 acres, with an occasional 20 or even 50 acres of plowable ground. These are separated by brushy ravines and creeks. The area used to be heavy to 40 and 60 acre family farms. They kept a few milk cows, chickens, and hogs. They sold milk and cream and eggs. It is mostly beef country now, with pastures running to hundreds of acres. Many old farmsteads have been abandoned as cattlemen buy up neighboring farms. The Hopkins lived in the last house on a dead-end road. David was out on his bike and was coming home at dusk. The road was a roller coaster of small hills and dips. David topped a small rise and saw a Bigfoot standing in the middle of the road. He laid his bike down to stop in time. They looked at each other for a moment, then the Bigfoot jumped the fence and ran off through the cornfield. David grabbed his bike, found that the chain was off, and pushed it home. He arrived out of breath and somewhat panicked, as might be expected. When he calmed down, he told of the classic dark, hairy, upright beast with a pronounced hump. His parents tried to convince him that he had seen a buffalo, as there were buffalo on a nearby farm. He would not be persuaded, but stuck firmly to his story. To my knowledge, this sighting was not widely reported. After my dad retired, we moved back to southern Iowa and drove for the Amish. He found a little meadow to set up, and he spent his nights camping out, hoping to get a glimpse of a Bigfoot. One day, we got this email from him. No, hey, how are you doing? Nothing else, just this. The farm dogs are barking. It is dusk. I am in my private place between an Iowa woods and an Iowa cornfield. It is very relaxing here for me. The moon is new again, having come a full cycle since I began spending most of my nights in this place of refuge. The dragonflies are few tonight, a reflection of their life cycle and the once plenteous mosquitoes, population now much diminished, to feed upon in this quiet meadow. I am secure from most mosquitoes in my mess shelter. No shelter from the elements, but wide open to see what is around me, and to be seen by the woodland creatures. And the farm dogs are barking. They always do so when something big is moving about, and indeed, there are many sounds in this summer night. The black house cat has made the rounds. Nothing much of interest in my larder tonight. He tries a nibble of well-seasoned watermelon, the fermented melon that the butterflies were so eager to feed on an hour earlier. But it lacks something, and he samples the night in a nervous manner. No leftover meat tonight. The coons are about. I can hear them rummaging around in the backyard, ever ready to snap up a frog in the wet grass, yet a bit careful lest they themselves be snapped up. And then I hear the most beautiful call I have ever heard. It is quite loud, most certainly from a big cat, hauntingly ethereal, high-pitched, and so melodious. I search my mind for comparison. The nearest I can come is the call of the great whales. It is massively larger than any house cat, but it sounds nothing like the big zoo cats. Clearly, this big Iowa cat has accepted me. He was not so friendly in nights past, growling and snarling ferociously in his outrage each time he scented me in his private meadow. Tonight, I am a part of his world. He is coming around the cornfield when he first calls out, only 100 yards or so away. His call has a wonderful, magical ring to it, kind of like it is coming from a concert hall. A short wait later, and he calls again, closer this time. The third call comes as he goes past me into the timber toward the creek. This call is perhaps more cat-like in that it is quieter and has more of a meow to it than the first two calls. He is in his world, and I am blessed. Signed, Larry. My father had degenerative heart failure and central sleep apnea. I say this to say that he was the first person in the U.S. to have a heart pacemaker, a breathing pacemaker, and a defibrillator. The doctors thought that the breathing pacemaker would set off the defibrillator, so my dad was a guinea pig, not the healthiest to be sleeping and hiking around the woods. When my father lay on his deathbed, my sister and I talked about neither of us thinking it would come to this, us kids sitting in a nursing home, watching him and his life as it dwindles away. We always thought we would get a call one day from a sheriff telling us they found him in the woods. My father passed in 2017, and as far as I know, unfortunately, never got to see a Bigfoot. You are welcome to use my first name and my father's name. I have been listening for forever now, and never thought I would break down and write to you. Please keep my name and information confidential. Thanks. I worked for the state of Connecticut from 1986 to 1993 or so. It was my summer job through high school and for a couple years after. The summer of 1990 was a great summer. I had just graduated high school, and it was going to be the best summer yet. I started working as a maintenance man for the first 4 years that I was there, and later became a park aide, sort of like a ranger in training. I loved it. We pretty much fixed up the state park. We drove trucks, rode mini bikes, and goofed off a lot. We did do work as well, and we had a lot of fun at that as well. Roger, who has now passed, was my boss, and you couldn't ask for a better boss. He was cool. One day, the park was full, and he said to me, "Jason, want me to show you how to clear out a park?" Perplexed, I looked at him and said, "Sure." Roger was the ranger there with a badge. He was the real deal. Well, Roger started checking car license plates and giving tickets to expired tags, worn-out tires, the whole nine yards. The word got out fast, and people left pretty quickly. Roger looked at me and winked and said, "That, my man, is how you thin the herd." I laughed. That night, we all were going to have a party on the beach after the park was closed to celebrate graduation. Sure, Roger knew about it, and the rule was, nobody drives if they've had even a sip of booze. And we always made sure that we didn't break his trust, and we followed that rule. Heck, 18 years old, partying in a closed state park with young lifeguard girls? Who would want to mess that up? The night was perfect. Full moon, cool summer night, and young people with their whole lives ahead of them, ready to take on the world. Boy, did the night go sideways in a hurry. Two locals showed up to crash the party. They were pretty drunk already, and to be blunt, I really hated this one guy. He was a real jerk. He was a local landscaper who was dating one of the lifeguards there. As soon as he showed up, you could feel the mood change for the worse. He was really full of himself, and it showed. Well, I wasn't going to let this stop the fun. I turned up the music and started to dance while making a joke and dancing a little crazy. Everyone laughed. Everyone except Mr. Wonderful. He called me a not-so-nice name, implying I didn't care for women. Now, folks, that's not the word he used, but again, I gotta keep it PG. I just ignored him and kept dancing, and I was getting more laughs. That's when he pushed me into the bushes. I have to say, it was pretty painful, but I didn't want to show that I was hurt. His own girlfriend called him a jerk and then walked over to help me up. I said, "I'll be fine. I'll just walk it off." I wish I had never taken that walk. There was a path we all used to cut up to the main office instead of walking all the way around the park to get to the shop and office. I was walking to the shop, and my mind just didn't compute what it was right in front of me. The Bigfoot was 9 feet or so tall, huge shoulders, long arms, and it looked pretty cool standing in the moonlight. I say that now, but when I was there, I thought I was just going to have a heart attack, literally. My heart was pounding outside my chest. Now looking back at it, I think he was as surprised to see me as I was to see him. How do I know it was a him? Well, a guy knows what those things are. I couldn't move. There was no smell like people have reported. Maybe he had just taken a bath. I don't know. After the shock was over of me surprising him and him surprising me, the real fear set in. Should I run? Should I call for help? He just turned to the woods and walked away. Never looked back. Never made a sound. Just walked. I watched him walk up a steep hill with little effort. He was huge. I know what I saw, and I never told anyone, and never will. It was for sure a Bigfoot. A huge Bigfoot. To this day, I have never been so afraid as I felt that night I came face to face with this magnificent creature. Well, thank you to everyone that sent these encounters in, and thank you to all of you for sticking with me on this journey tonight. And like I said, it was a little bit of a mixed bag, but I do hope you enjoyed it all. Otherwise, I think this is going to do it for tonight. Until we meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.